Hello, this is Dr. Lori. Welcome to this third video discussing causation. So far in other videos, we've talked about the idea of causal relationships, and we've talked about associated but not causal. And so in this video, I'd like to really kind of delve into the idea of bias or systematic error. With bias, I have evaluated a relationship and come to a conclusion, and my conclusion is wrong. Bias is a big problem with research because a lot of times the biases that are created in studies can't be fixed in any other way. If we have confounding, we can do certain types of analysis. We can design our study in such a way that it kind of minimizes that sort of thing. If we have bias, we cannot fix that. For a lot of the different kinds of bias. We have the wrong data. We can't undo the effect of bias because a lot of times we don't know exactly what it's doing to our relationship. And so we come to the wrong conclusion. We can come to the wrong conclusion because of bias, this systematic error. So as a quick reminder, I just want to go back to this notion that here we have a population. Because of the constraints of studies, we can't study everybody, so often we'll take a sample from that population. Once we have all the people in our study, then we can collect the data or the variables, measure things. We can measure their height and weight. We can ask them questions on a questionnaire. We can do all kinds of things where we collect data. But then ultimately, we want to go and we want to infer back to how that relates to the entire population. And so I want to talk about a couple of different things here. First of all, the notion that bias can come from a variety of different places. There are so many kinds of bias that we would never be able to come up with a comprehensive list. So instead of that, I want you to think of bias as primarily coming from a couple of different places. First of all, bias can come from the notion that we picked a specific subgroup to study out of the larger population. Ideally, that sample would be representative of the population. And so they would represent the distribution of ages, they would evenly represent men and women, they would represent the different race ethnicities. But if we draw our sample in such a way that they don't represent the population, then that's called something called assembly bias. In other words, we collected a group of people that don't represent the overall population. That's a problem because now we have some great study results that only apply to our one little sample of people, and that's not what we're after. We drew the sample so that we can infer back to the whole entire population. So what we want to do is put checks and balances in place so that we can be reasonably confident that the group of people that we have assembled, this group of people, represents the population. The second place that bias can enter in is how we measure. All of those variables. In other words, here's this vast group of people that's in front of us, our sample, and we're trying to detect things about them. So we call that detection bias. And that has to do with the variables. In other words, a common example is if we were to measure everybody with high heels on, with their shoes on, then the measurement would be taller than the actual person. And so this is a bias. It's typically bias is in one direction. It could be that the machine is calibrated incorrectly in a lab, or we ask questions in such a way that people overinflate their answers consistently. And so we're detecting something that's different than the true actual measurement that we should see in the data. So those are two of the primary places that bias can come from. Now, another important thing that kind of goes along with this whole notion of measurement or detecting is the idea about validity. So there's, and I'll just kind of put them up here, validity. There's internal validity and there's external. And internal validity means that what we did is valid inside of our particular sample, our study. So when I measure things for my sample, did I actually measure what I think I measured? If I asked people, remember back 20 or 30 years and tell me something about yourself, they might want to help me out. They might overinflate the answers because they think they're helping my research, or they might underestimate just because it's hard to remember that far back. And so internal validity asks the question, did I measure what I think I measured? Did I get the correct data? External validity, on the other hand, has more to do with this inference back to the population. Another word for external validity is generalizability. Can I generalize what I found in my study to a larger group? Can I generalize out to this larger population? Do my findings apply to somebody who wasn't part of this study? A really good example of this was when they did a study on, it was called the Physicians Study, and so they collected data on only male physicians because that was more common to be male, and they didn't want to complicate it with things like hormones and female physiology at the time. They thought that was a good idea. So they only collected data on males who were physicians. And what they found is that partway through the study, their risk for certain diseases or outcomes was so much lower than the population at large that they had to extend the study. They had to go longer years and have more people in it than they had originally imagined to get their findings, because physicians, on average, probably have different habits. They are, if we have this sample of physicians, they are inherently different from the population on certain things, and one of them is that they are much less likely to get sick than the average population. They're employed, they are not exposed to poverty in general, except that they have student loans forever. They maybe have significantly greater access to care, even if they didn't have any money. They have all their friends would be able to help them with whatever diseases they encountered. And so, how much can we generalize the findings that we got from that particular study? They were maybe looking at aspirin and cardiovascular disease, which we know can be a real positive thing. Well, does it apply to women the same as men? Maybe not. Does it apply to other race ethnic groups that were very underrepresented in the physician population at that time? They were much more likely to be non-Hispanic white. So, can these results that we found apply to other people outside of that particular group that we studied? And sometimes the answer is no. Is it generalizable? Do we have external validity? So, those are some of the important concepts that we have when we are talking about bias. Here we are, we're wrong, our conclusion is wrong, and why. So thank you for joining me for this video, and we'll see you in the next one.